Thank you so much. Thank you, Stephanie. It's hard to see you, so if I do this once in a while, it helps. I just want to say to the community center here, the Jewish Community Center, how wonderful it has been to work with you. And my publisher and the book, the local wonderful independent book people, and my staff coordinating the scheduling, and I'm so grateful to you all for coming out tonight. Because if you weren't here, I would really be sad. And you're here, and it's wonderful, because I think we'll have some fun together. I also wanted you to know that my husband, Stuart, is here. I don't know exactly where you are, honey. Where are you? He's way in the back. He's way in the back, but I just wanted you to applaud him, because as I say in the book, he married Debbie Reynolds, and he woke up with gold in my ear. And just think about that. That is one of my favorite lines. So a lot of you have known me for a very long time, but I know that you don't know all this, you don't know really any of the stories that I've put forth in this book, because they occurred behind the scenes, deep inside the political world, deep inside the halls of the House of Representatives or the United States Senate. They occurred on visits made around the world, and I really think you're going to find them interesting and informative. And I think what you will take away from the book is not only a deeper knowledge of how it really works inside the inside, but the importance of who's in those rooms when these decisions are made. And of course, all of you know the importance of elections, and all of you understand that. And I know when we have the question time, I'm sure you'll have a lot of questions about what's happening now. And that's fine, and I hope you will feel free to ask any and all questions, regardless of whether they are discussions of past events or current events that are happening now. So just to set the stage for what I've been told, I will speak to you for about a half hour to 45 minutes, depending on how it goes. If I notice people are like that, I'll stop. And then we'll have another half hour to 45 minutes for questions. Then we'll go sign books. And I hope you will buy the book, because what I hope tonight will do is give you a little bit of a preview of it. Why did we call it The Art of Tough? It kind of happened this way. You know me a long time, and you know I'm not afraid to stand up and say what I think, even if what I think is not in the mainstream of the moment, or being willing to cast a vote, even if I may be almost alone. And you also know that I evoke a lot of discussion from many people, pundits and so on, some of which are pretty rude, which you'll hear about. And during these years, people would keep coming up to me and saying, how can you stand it? Why do you do this? How do you handle it? You're tough. And I would always say, I'm not tough, I'm just me. This is who I am, I'm an ordinary kid. I grew up in Brooklyn. Hello, anybody else? You know, I learned you gotta take care of yourself. I learned you gotta watch what's going on. But went to public school my whole life, kindergarten through college, and I'm not particularly tough. But as the years went by, I thought, you know what? I think I am. And I started, when I sat down to write the book, the first thing I did was write all the stories that I wanted to share with you and all my readers. Stories that, again, you haven't heard. But then I thought, I can also make this an empowerment book. How do you get to be tough? Whether you are retired or whether you are working, whether you're a lawyer, a nurse, a doctor, or a politician, or a janitor, or anything else, there will be people who will try to come after you, don't like your ideas, shut you down, shut you up, and all the rest. So how do you get to a place where you actually wear that as a badge of honor and you are not fearful? And so I was thinking, young or old, this is something I think I want to share. And what I found out when I sat down to write the book and write that part of it was that even though I thought going into it that it was my dad who taught me all these lessons, my dad was the only one of 9 children born in America. They all escaped Russia. He was the only one, was the youngest one, and the only one to ever go to college at night and get his degree. And then when he was about 40, and I think I was 10, he got his law degree. And he was a spectacular human being. I write a lot about my parents in this. But I found out it was mostly my mother, who had never graduated from high school, who had wisdom beyond what I can even say in this book, and who taught me these lessons. So as I read from the book a little bit tonight, with that introduction, put that into context. When I start the book, what I learned about politics, let me break away from my own train of thought. What I learned about politics is if you have a negative and you know it's going to come out, start with it with the people. You know, say, I know you didn't like when I voted this way, but I learned from it and so on. So what I decided to do in the book is get right to why I'm controversial and to really explain why I had to learn the art of tough and utilize it in my life. Okay, hang on. This is how the first chapter starts. The beginning of the book, the preface, is written by Kirsten Gillibrand. Do you know who she is? The wonderful senator from New York. And one of the reasons I can leave is because I'm leaving behind people like her, right? She's going to take up all those things I do. So she wrote that. But then we get to the chapter. So it starts this way. The first lessons of tough. I'm no martial artist or big-time, high-stakes moneymaker. I barely measure 5 feet, maybe 5'3" in my heels, and no one's ever accused me of having a menacing presence. No, I have lived with an emotional intensity, a sense of indignation, determination, and sometimes outrage that has often inspired opposing reactions among my political colleagues, voters, and right-wing pundits who have said these and other quotable things about me. So I'm going to give you just a couple of the quotes and entice you to read the rest. How's this one? Ann Coulter. Know her? Okay, ready? Barbara Boxer is a great candidate for the Democratic Party. Female and learning disabled. Now that's one of the nicer ones that I'm going to read you. Here's another one. Barbara Boxer continues to prove that she is unfit for any office higher than turd inspector. And this one is, I mean, some of these I can't even read because it's Friday night, it's the Sabbath, and I don't want to even mention this, but here's one. This is unreal. Anyone know Michael Savage? God, I hope he's not here tonight. This is one of the worst, or best, depending on your point of view. In the future, Barbara Boxer may be remembered as the Frau Dr. Mengele of the U.S. Senate. And he goes on, Dr. Joseph Mengele, the Nazi war criminal who directed merciless human experiments, may have decided to come back as a woman. Yeah. So you see, art of tough, you get it? So how do you handle this? Well, there are 9 rules I discovered when I sat down to write the book, and I'm going to share one of them with you. One of my favorite ones. One of the rules of the art of tough is never act out of anger. In other words, when someone says something like that, what's your first reaction? You know, think about it, decide on a course. And I want to tell you, that did not come easy for me. And I'm going to tell you about a story when I was in the sixth grade, where I learned the vast majority of these rules. But here's this one. Beware of anger. Being tough doesn't give you the license to dive into an angry rage. That can lead to uncontrollable violence. I know. I did an awful thing in anger when I was in the sixth grade. There was one kid, his name was Albert, who was harassing me and driving me nuts, pulling my hair, chasing me around, shouting nasty things every day. Honestly, I don't know why he was doing it, but boys in those days engage in this behavior, right, ladies of my age? Yeah, you remember it. And they wanted to get our attention. I was little, still am, and so was Albert, so I was an easy target for him. The antics were mostly harmless, but to me it was adding up. I didn't want this attention from him. I had just gone through the same sort of problem with another kid named Jay, who chased me down a dirt hill filled with broken glass, which was my path home from school, and one day the predictable happened. On my usual run away from Jay activity, I tripped, flying through the air, landing on my knees and elbows, thoroughly embarrassed. When I got home, Mom told me she was going to the principal's office to put an end to it. And of course, I talk about Mom did, but sadly for me, Jay's mom went too. And so it became, my Jay would never do this. And my mother said, look at her elbows, look at her knees. Anyway, it was a draw. So I decided this was a she said thing, and I wasn't going that route. I was going to take matters into my own hands. Big mistake. Toward the end of the school day, when the halls were emptying out and no one was watching, Albert insulted me, something about my height and my clothes. He got up in my face, he punched me in the shoulder, and I lost it. I took my number two sharp pencil out of my pencil case, and I stabbed him in the upper arm where you get a vaccination. Fortunately, no one saw this happen, but oh my God, it was awful. Albert started crying and so did I, but neither of us made it public. Me, because I lost it and I knew it. Albert, because he deserved it and he knew it. I was immediately stunned at my own loss of control. What I'd done was contrary to everything I was taught by my parents. I was ashamed, but my punishment was coming. The self-inflicted punishment of anguish. And then I go through the rest, which was this. Albert, in my neighborhood, there were only Jews, Italians, and Irish. I never met a WASP until I met Pete Stark in Congress. And when I said, thank God, I finally met a WASP, he said, I'm Unitarian. So it took me a long time. So Albert was Italian, and I'm after this horrible incident, which I decided to forget it, and he wanted to forget it. I'm walking back from school. I see a black crepe cloth over his house. And in those years, that's what the Italian Catholics would do if there was a death. Now I knew I'd killed him. There was a black crepe. He was absent from school for 2 days. There was a black crepe, and I was out of my mind. I really thought I murdered the kid. So I go home to my mother. Of course, I finally take it to her. She says, what's wrong with you, Babs? So I said, tell her, and she's appalled. How could you ever do this? This is terrible. She says, but I don't think you killed him. She said, I'm going to call the principal. So she does, and she finds out it was his grandpa. And I mean, I was really sad for his grandpa, but I was so happy it wasn't Albert. When Albert came back, we hugged, and I learned, do not use violence. Do not act out of anger. It's terrible thing that happens to you when you do it. So the art of tough is some of the things are a little counterintuitive in it. And one of the things I learned is you don't act out of anger. I'll give you an example. When I got to the House of Representatives, how many of you remember those years when I got to the House? Some of you remember, thank you for your support. It was the 80s. Oh my God. I'll never forget it because my slogan was something, I don't know how I did it and how it actually worked, was Barbara Boxer gives a damn. I can't believe that it was all over on posters. And then we added a line at the bottom, my brilliant campaign manager, Ronald Reagan doesn't. So that was all over the city here. It worked, but it was a lot of chutzpah, let me put it that way. So I get to the House and I come with all the sensibilities of California and I'm ready to work and work out and do everything, and I find out there's no real woman's gym. It's just a tiny little box about, you know, seriously, I don't know, maybe it's 500 square feet, the whole woman's gym, and it has five big hair dryers, you know, the kind that have the that was it. Because they thought women will come there, wash their hair, dry it, and that was the gym. I was incensed about it, but don't act out of anger, right? So I fell back on something I'd learned as a child, which is write funny lyrics to songs and use your sense of humor. Don't act out of anger because this was clearly prejudicial, but I have to tell you before, I'm actually gonna sing that song a little bit for you. I will tell you what really got us going. I had a wonderful staff person named Claudette, and she was very athletic, and she would teach people how to do aerobics. So I said, Claudette, would you teach the women, congresswomen, how to do aerobics? And we took the women's gym, we tried. And so I'll tell you who came. Geraldine Ferraro, I loved. Barbara Mikulski, who I love. Olympia Snow, all who I love. Barbara Kennelly, and I think there were two others. And so we're standing, and she says, okay, everybody, stretch your arms out. We were hitting each other, because it's such a small room. So she says, oh, some of you go in the back. So we stretch our arms out. Then she says, now take your arms, make a muscle, and put them up in the sky. Put them up in the sky. Okay, we do that. Then she says, now I want you to put your hands on your hips, at which point Mikulski yells out, if I had hips, I wouldn't be here. Now, she's so funny that was the end of it. It was such a small space. We said, okay, this is it. We're going on a mission. We have to get in the gym. So I took it to all the elderly gentlemen who were in charge of all this. No, we couldn't possibly do that. Does it don't work out? And, you know, where's your changing room? I said, well, we'll use the old gym as the changing room. We just want to use the machines. This isn't going to work. So I was really getting upset about it. It was real prejudice. But I wanted to get it done without anger. So I said to two female senators, Mary Rose Okar and Marcy Kaptur. Anyone know who they are? They're from a couple of people from Ohio. I said, can you carry a tune? They said, yeah. So he talked to Tony Coelho and he said, you know what? If you use a sense of humor, and I know you like to write these lyrics, sing it for Tip O'Neill. And sing it for Tip, he was the speaker, and a few of the other guys who are in charge of this, and maybe it'll work. So I write the words to 5'2", Eyes of Blue. You know that song?
Yeah.
Okay, here it goes. And we practice it. We had a guitarist. We smiled, belying how we really felt, like this was ridiculous, but we did it. And we sang this. Exercise, glamorize, where to go will you advise? Can't everybody use your gym? Equal rights, we'll wear tights. Let's avoid those macho fights. Can't everybody use your gym? And it went on to a big finish. We're only asking. Anyway, we get in the gym. We get in the gym. My words got us in the gym. Now, all through the years, I wrote songs about the nuclear freeze, ending the war in Iraq. Don't cry for me, Condoleezza. You are the one who told us of tubes aluminum, of weapons there were none. Your truth was half-baked, like yellow fake cake. So I tried everything to end that war. And I would love to... I would love to tell you that I was successful only once. We got in the gym. And the women there now are using it. And of course, now I'm stuck in the Senate with a woman's gym, but that's a whole other thing, and I'm happy. It's all good, as they say. So that's some of the funny things you're going to find in my book, including some stories about what it was like as a woman in 1972. The only time I ever lost an election was that race, and I tell some of these amazing things that happened, which I'll just tell you about, not read them, but I would go door to door because it was, anybody from Marin here tonight? All right, thank you so much. So it was the second district of Marin, and I would walk door to door, knock on doors. And, you know, I got pretty good at it. It's hard to know how effective, but I never didn't win that race, but it was pretty close. So it would go like this. Yes, who's there? Barbara Boxer, I'm running for supervisor. Door opens, first thing. I didn't know you'd be so short. That was the first thing. What are you gonna say about that? And I said, oh, yeah. And then she said, you know, I don't think I can vote for you. I said, why not? She says, because you have four kids, you're neglecting. I said, no, I don't, I have two kids. She says, I read about it. You have four kids. I said, lady, I gave birth twice, and I'll never forget it. That was it, just twice. So I know. And at that moment, I recognized something. I was never going to get that vote. I could have stopped a missile coming right at her with my bare hand. That was it. That was the kind of praise. Letters to the editor. Because if you were running back then, in 1972, that was just the very beginning of the women's movement. Something was wrong with you. Either you had a terrible marriage, you had to get away from your husband, or you were divorced, oh my God. Or you were gay, oh. And they had everything, or you were a spinster. They had all these reasons why something was wrong with you. And that's all left over from World War II, because remember, Rosie the Riveter, and the women did a great job, but then they needed the jobs back for the guys. And that's a whole other story. But that's a leftover from that. So it was pretty amazing. I want to read a more serious, there's a lot of serious stuff in the book. There's a lot of fun stuff and a lot of serious stuff. I have a lot of heroes. I have a lot of heroes. Nancy Pelosi's a hero. Tip O'Neill is a hero. I have a lot, and one of them is John Lewis. And how many of you know John? You know what John went through in the civil rights movement, just pressing ahead, desegregation, getting beaten up, getting a plate in his head, and all these awful things. And I'm gonna read you from a little amazing story I had with John. Despite the misery he saw, the hatred he stared down, the wounds he received, John is one of the most positive people I've ever met or worked with. John's compassion, understanding, and willingness to walk in someone else's shoes, even though his own shoes were tough enough, became evident to me in a most unexpected way. Back in 1988, then Majority Whip Tony Coelho led a 15-member delegation from the House of Representatives to the Middle East that included both me and the newly elected John Lewis. It was the time of the first Intifada, and tensions between Israelis and Palestinians were increasingly dangerous, with violence and suffering all around. We did what we could in Israel when we were there on this trip to help get the parties back to the peace table And then we went to Morocco, one of Israel's best friends in the region. I was particularly eager to meet with King Hassan II, the reigning monarch of the country, and seek his help figuring out the best way to ease tensions between Israel and the Palestinians. John was the only African American in our delegation. I was the only woman and the only Jewish member. There was much fuss and preparation before our meeting with the king at one of his many palaces in Marrakesh, a fascinating old city I wish we'd had more time to see. We were told to enter and wait in an arena-sized reception area that was decorated with beautiful posh couches and tables, as if 25 separate living rooms were arranged in that large space. Then we were summoned into an opulent meeting room. I remember leather-bound notebooks and pens for each of us, and men with curlicue ballerina shoes walking in and out of the room with tea and exotic treats to eat. I'd been in some beautiful meeting rooms over the years, but never one as majestic. It's good to be the king. When King Hassan arrived, everyone was cordial. But when the conversation got around to our trip to Israel, he suddenly became angry and went on a tirade. We'd been talking about Israel's strong push to end the Intifada and how the situation was evolving into a dangerous atmosphere for both sides. And this is what the king said: "If that's the Jewish mind, we are all in trouble." And he continued to use the phrase, "the Jewish mind." He became angrier and angrier. And then I realized I couldn't bear to be in that room with him. So I stood up. The art of tough kicked in. My heart was beating so fast that I dared not speak. It was awful to hear the king keep referring to the Jewish mind. I looked at Tony to convey my discomfort. He knew me well, and he stood up too. He got it. "This meeting is over," he said. One by one, our delegation of 15 stood up and everyone walked out silently, which I could tell shocked the king and all of his party. I guess getting walked out on wasn't something that had ever happened to Hassan before. We went to the bus that had brought us to the palace. As we entered, everyone was quiet until one of my colleagues broke the silence. "Barbara, you really overreacted to that comment by the king. He didn't mean anything by it." I was shocked. I said, "You don't say the Jewish mind. That's indicative of someone who has a deep prejudice," I insisted, "and a discriminatory attitude toward an entire religion." But then a couple of others who agreed I'd made a big mistake chimed in. They too thought I ruined the entire occasion. Things were looking bad for my popularity rating. But suddenly, a deep, authoritative voice came, ironically, from the back of the van. "Barbara's right," the voice said. "I know prejudice when I hear it." It was John Lewis, putting an end to the discussion. It was over. Every person in that van respected and accepted John's view. As a new member of the House, it would have been very easy for him to go along with the sentiment that had started to spread in that van, but he did not do that. He spoke his own mind without equivocation, and the entire atmosphere changed. I loved him so much at that moment, and I still do. That's my story about John. So, where's Stephanie? Should we go on a bit longer?
We have a nice pile of questions.
Well, wait, do you want me to tell one more story?
Yes.
Okay, I'll go one more story. There's so many, I can't tell them all. You have to buy the book. Okay, let me see which one I will go to. I want to talk about Anita Hill. Oh, Anita Hill, so brave. You know what happened is that Clarence Thomas had been put up for the Supreme Court for Marshall's seat. And the Senate had just defeated Bork. So now they're in this atmosphere where they're kind of rushing through Clarence Thomas's hearing. And I remember I'm on the way, I was thinking of running for the Senate, actually was on my way to a bit of an organizing meeting in San Francisco at the time. And we hear on the radio that Anita Hill, this respected law professor, is making charges that she was harassed by him inappropriately. So Pat Schroeder and I organized the women of the House. Some of them stayed behind in the House to give their little one-minute speeches as to why they had to reopen the hearings. And we march up the Senate steps. Did anybody here remember that photo? Raise your hand. Of the women of the House, about six or seven of us, marching up the stairs. Now, to me, it's a moment. Because when you look at the photo, and by the way, it is in the book, what you see is the body language of the women, me and my colleagues. We couldn't believe that we had to really do this, but we were determined to tell George Mitchell, the Democratic Senate leader, he needed to open up these hearings. Well, we get up the steps, and they're all having lunch, my Democratic colleagues, and I know because I have it now, I'm inside that room every Tuesday. Knock on the door. It seems like I knock on the door a lot. So knock on the door, and a woman opens. It's Mitchell's assistant, and she says, yes. And we say, we want to go and speak to the senators because we found out about Anita Hill. You've got to open up the hearings. She says, we don't allow strangers in the Senate. What? I actually wrote a book called Strangers in the Senate because I was so, I said, what are you talking about? We have 100 years of experience between us. No, you can't come in. So then the art of tough kicked in. Remember, don't get angry, get even. So I said to her, look, we don't want to cause any trouble. We just want to talk to George. We're not going away. And if we do walk back down, what do you see at the bottom of these stairs? And she says, about 35 cameras. I said, yeah, do you really want us to go down there and say Mitchell wouldn't meet with us? Wait a minute, she says. So we get in, we talk to George. He promises us he's going to reopen the hearings, and he does. Well, if you watch those hearings, what you would have seen is what the whole country saw. Guess what? Not one woman on the Judiciary Committee. And extrapolating from that, only two women out of 100 in the entire United States Senate. So when I say to you, I got there because of Anita Hill, I'm not being humble about it. I mean, I guess I could say it was my winning personality. Trust me, Diane had that first seat. The two of us were running, Diane Feinstein. I wasn't known. I was running from a little House seat. The only reason that people voted for both of us, even though there was some prejudice, they did it is because they took a look at the Senate and they said, what is wrong with this? But the part I'm going to read to you is a brief part here, because in writing the book, I sat down and I realized I had made a huge and terrible mistake. After I made that walk, I honestly thought when Anita Hill would testify, that would be the end for Clarence Thomas. He would not get confirmed because she was so credible and had such an incredible reputation, law professor and all the rest, articulate. And so I took my eye off the ball and I realized you can't do that. I learned that lesson, but I'll read you what I wrote. I blame myself for not focusing more on what was happening behind the scenes after we marched up the steps of the Senate. I might have learned in real time what I learned later, that the committee had refused to allow the testimony of Angela Wright and Rose Jourdain, both of whom were prepared to say that Thomas had made unsolicited sexual advances. Wright, who worked for Thomas at the EEOC until he fired her, said he had pressured her for dates, asked about the size of her breasts, made similar comments about other women. Jourdain said Thomas was always commenting on her body. And Sukari Hardnett, another former Thomas assistant, told the judiciary staff, quote, if you were young, black, female, reasonably attractive, and worked directly for Thomas, you knew full well you were being inspected and auditioned as a female. And then there was also, because I had taken my eye off the ball after the fact, I should have known these things. I didn't, I learned them later. In May of 93, an article in the New Yorker by Jane Mayer and Jill Abramson stated that Joe Biden had abdicated control of the confirmation hearings and didn't call four women who traveled to Washington to corroborate Anita's claims, including Wright and Jourdain. They also claimed Thomas had lied under oath, and it goes on. And then I end this part saying this. It's a long, sad story, and there's even more. In 2010, Clarence Thomas's wife, Virginia, left a voicemail message on Anita Hill's office phone at Brandeis University over a weekend, demanding that the professor say she was sorry for accusing her husband of sexually harassing her. And this is what was left on the voicemail. Quote, I would love you to consider an apology sometime and some full explanation of why you did what you did with my husband. The voicemail said in part, according to NBC News. She went on, so give it some thought and certainly pray about this and come to understand why you did what you did. And I write, incredible. Professor Hill called the message inappropriate, reported it to her employer's security department, who in turn reported it to the FBI. Further, Professor Hill said she has no reason to atone. Quote, I have no intention of apologizing because I testified truthfully about my experience and I stand by that testimony, she said in a statement to NBC News. So Anita Hill's story touched the hearts of women and caring men across the nation, and I thank her over and over again, and I had the chance to see her recently, for having that courage, for being tough, and making sure that now, this started it, instead of just two women in the Senate, we have 20. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Boxer. There's many questions. I'm going to try to group them. Okay. The first one.
Talk louder for me.
Sure. Donald Trump claims that...
Oh, no! So quickly you got to it.
Sorry. There are a lot of questions about Donald Trump. Donald Trump claims that he is tough and artful in deal-making. How would you compare your practice of tough and artful with his?
Well, he's a hater. And my parents taught me never to hate. He's a hater. And that's not tough. In a way, it's cowardly what he does. And he's a bully. So it's the opposite of the art of tough. I mean, anyone who is doing what he is now, I mean, every day it's something new. The latest thing is this attack on this judge. And I want to make a statement here. I am not a lawyer, although I am married to one, my son is one, and my father was one. So I'm not saying this is legally a fact. But I always thought you're not supposed to intimidate a judge who is hearing your case. And yeah, I mean, so even if it's not a legal problem, it's a moral problem. And to call a man who's born in the Midwest a Mexican, that's like calling me a half Russian, a half Polish person. I mean, what is he thinking? So don't get me started. But I already have started, so I will continue down this road. I'm sure we have some more. But he does not know the art of anything. He's just, you know, a bull in a china shop and the worst thing we could ever have.
Okay. How much of the art of tough is a product of your Jewish upbringing?
Oh, what a good question. Did you hear her? I think a lot of it has to do with the way I was raised by my parents, both Jewish. And the Holocaust was in the, and I talk a lot about that in the book, was probably the first issue that ever was brought to my attention by my parents, because when I was a little girl, it was going on. And by the time I was 10, that was 1950, you know, everyone was talking about it in the 40s and the 50s. And I read The Diary of Anne Frank. How many people read that as little kids? unbelievable. We all, so many of us have. And what I came to realize at a pretty young age is, you know, easily that could have been me. You know, when Barack Obama said I could have been Trayvon Martin, I got it. And I get the chills thinking about that. And I could have been Anne Frank, and you could have been Anne Frank, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you. And so I started to understand at an early age that why would someone want to hurt anybody just because they might be a little different? Then when I was also about that same age, my father would take me to Ebbets Field, and I watched Jackie Robinson. I fell in love with Jackie, me and a million other people. But he was spit at and taunted, and it was the same lesson over and over again that came back to, you know, civil rights, Holocaust, what's going on? This hatred, this that can turn to unbelievable tragedy and pain. So I do think because I was aware of these things, I went back to see Anne Frank's house at least three times. Stu and I did. And it just, every time, I have a real problem going to the Holocaust museums now. It feels too raw. And look how old I am, and I still feel it so much right here. So I think that experience and the fact that my parents, you know, always said, you hear someone say something like that, you don't just be quiet, you know, you just step up. And I talk about the lessons and how I learned it. It's, you know, little ways. But yeah, I think it was a very big part, not to mention just other things that I learned from them about warmth and friendship and loyalty and things like that. So yes, I think culturally it made me who I am. I just think all of us, our lives make us who we are. And I was lucky to have these. It grew up pretty without anything really materially, but I had everything.
What legislative success or successes are you most proud of?
Well, if you buy the book, there are 50 top accomplishments out of 1,000 things I got done. And I'll just cite a couple. I teamed up with a Republican senator, because you have to work across the aisle, you get nothing done, it's just the way it is. And we got through the first ever after-school program, federal after-school funding. And if you look at any of the FBI statistics, the crime rate for juveniles just takes off right at the end of school hour. You know, it's not rocket science, but we need to keep the kids busy. And they get in trouble, and it's just the way it is. So we teamed up, and we got it done. And because of that, and that was in the early 2000s, 1 million children a year get after school. I'm very proud of that, very proud of that. And they're out of trouble, and they're focused, and it makes a difference. The second thing I would cite is more than 1 million acres in wilderness in California. I'm so proud of that, too. Setting the standards for drinking water, and you know how important that is given what's happened, to protect vulnerable populations like kids and pregnant women and people with AIDS and disabilities, because they always, before my legislation, the standards were set to protect a 150-pound man. Well, that's good if you're a 150-pound man, but there's a lot of people that aren't 150-pound men. And we need to protect everyone. So that was another one. Getting the first ever comprehensive casualty care center for our veterans who were so wounded after the war in Iraq, which I did everything to stop. And I just couldn't until we elected Barack Obama. Thank God he stopped it. But that was the worst 8 years of going on and on with W and not being able to stop it. And we had all these soldiers coming back with the worst wounds, mental wounds, physical wounds, everything, brain wounds. And we had no comprehensive casualty care center in California. They had to go to Texas or Walter Reed. So we have one in San Diego. I'm very, very proud of that. But there are so many. The highway bill, we saved the highway trust fund. I did that with Mitch McConnell. who I didn't talk to for 20 years. I'm not, except to say hi, bye. Because, as you will read in the book, there was a big, big problem with a senator when I first got to the Senate, and Mitch tried to, let's just say, I won't say cover it up exactly, but try to kind of slap on the wrist the thing, and it wasn't right. And so I got in his way, and he threatened me in certain ways politically. And so we didn't talk. And then 2015 came, and the Highway Trust Fund was running out of money, and the roads are a mess, and we're losing jobs, and we can't fix our roads or fix our bridges, 66,000 of which are structurally deficient. So I said, okay, this is the moment. And we worked together, and we got it done. And it was terrific, because let me tell you, when that's some combination. If McConnell and Boxer are for something, you pretty well know it's okay. You know, you got permission, because this is amazing. And we did get it done, a five-year bill, just tens of thousands of millions of jobs and businesses saved. And it was very, very rewarding for both of us. As a matter of fact, we actually went out to dinner with our staff, and he gave me a slugger bat from Kentucky, and I gave him a tie with bridges on it. And so it goes. And it just shows you anything can happen, and usually does in my life. But it was a very tough 20 years, because one of the things I talk about in The Art of Tough is, yeah, you got to forgive. That's one of the rules. But if somebody touches your heart in a way, they get too deep in there and it's too hurtful, they don't exist. You know, hi, bye, how are you, but that's it. It's tough. And 20 years worth of that. And we saved the Highway Trust Fund. I'm very happy. Okay.
Since you brought up Mitch McConnell, I'm going to segue to this question about the confirmation of President Obama's nominee for Supreme Court.
Yeah.
So how likely do you think it is that that will happen?
Merrick Garland, the Supreme Court nominee, 100% qualified, amazing candidate. I met with him, had the privilege to do that. This is a candidate that everyone should get behind, because he has experience, and his experience shows that he's very, very thoughtful, that he doesn't bring prejudice to the table. He brings an open mind, an open heart, and he can really work across the aisle. It's somebody we need. And it is outrageous that the Republicans under Mitch McConnell's leadership say, forget it. He's not even going to have a hearing. Now, if you read the Constitution, which is, you can read, it's very easy, Article 2, Section 2, Clause 2, it says, the president shall nominate when there's a vacancy on the court, and the Senate shall advise the consent. It doesn't say, unless the Senate doesn't like the president. It doesn't say, unless the president's in another party. It doesn't say, unless you're in a bad mood. It says, the president shall nominate, and the Senate shall advise the consent. And to me, it is beyond outrageous. It doesn't say you have to vote for the guy. You can filibuster him too. You don't want him. But to not even have a hearing in the Judiciary Committee, I'm going to tell you something. This has never happened before. And what I hope is that people in this country, there's so much anger out there. There's so many emotions. But this is an insult to you, to the American people. You have a court that could be deadlocked 4-4 on issues relating to health, for example, and issues relating to employment, discrimination, voting rights, and you have no Supreme Court. They get deadlocked 4-4. You cannot have that. And it's so hard to make it a voting issue, and I hope some of you will talk to your friends who might be on the fence. This should not be forgotten. This is an insult to the American people, to the Constitution, to the founders of the country, to President Obama, and I am stunned at it. So you're asking, the person asking, it's a great question, what do I think will happen? At this point, nothing. And I don't know if it changes after the election, maybe in a lame duck, but I don't see signs of that at this point.
Thank you.
And let me just, P.S. The way it could change if people really, really get mad about it and, you know, flood the offices with letters and so on, you tell me, is this an issue that people are going to sit down and, you know? I don't know. And it's very tough. So.
Thank you. So there are several questions about Hillary and Bernie. And so I'm going to try to combine the
sure.
top two.
And I think this is, we're getting to the end, maybe
yeah.
two more?
Sure.
Okay.
So the question is, why do you think younger women are supporting Bernie Sanders and not Hillary Clinton? And then the connected question is, why do you think the top three reasons why people don't like Hillary Clinton?
Okay. Okay. Bernie has hit a chord with a lot of young people because he's an aspirational politician. He is my friend. I know him very well. Hillary is my friend. I know her very well. Bernie is an aspirational politician, and he touches the hearts. As far as getting it done, doesn't happen. I'm being sincere. Doesn't happen. And young people are aspirational. I mean, I was, and so I love them. I just hope they don't get angry if and when, you know, we see the handwriting on the wall, which will probably be Tuesday, because Hillary's got 3 million more votes than Bernie, and she'll have the delegates by Tuesday. And a lot of it's up to Bernie. You know, I had some bad experiences with some of his supporters, but they were not the young ones. Did you see what happened in Las Vegas? Yeah, I thought the art of tough would prevail. It didn't work. I tried everything. I tried sense of humor. I tried bringing everyone together. It was not helpful. It didn't work. So there's a lot of this anger. But I told Bernie when I called him about it that 95%, no more, 98% of his people were respectful and terrific and sitting and listening. It was only about 50 older people, not younger ones, that were at the foot of the stage, and I didn't know if they were going to rush it or throw stuff or whatever. And he said he was surprised. He said, well, it doesn't sound like those are my people. And I said, they may not be your people. I don't know who they were. And maybe they weren't. You know, it was Las Vegas. Who knows what was going on? I said, go take a look and see. Maybe they just kind of were troublemakers, but not really part of your campaign. So I don't know. He said he would do that. But Hillary, why isn't she liked? Okay. First of all, I take issue with that. For a woman who isn't liked, she's still getting more votes than Bernie, and she's going to be our nominee, number one. But I'll grant you, she has high negatives. If you look at her ratings right after she finished being Secretary of State, they were very high, about 60, 59, they were very high. Then suddenly there were 18 people running in the Republican Party, remember? Remember? Ted Cruz, for example. He's a very bipartisan figure. Republicans and Democrats in the Senate hate him. And I'm being honest. But he was very hateful toward her. And then Rick Perry, he was hateful toward her. And you could just go down the list. So it's pounding, 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 pounding. Then you've got these right-wing beauties who've gone after your senator here, going after her. night and day, night and day. So what I want you to appreciate is that some of the things people say about her are very interesting to me, and I want to give you my perspective. I'm not trying to convince anybody. I'm just telling you how I feel. People say, oh, Bernie, but he's so aspirational and inspirational and authentic. He's so authentic. And Trump is so authentic. And Hillary's just not authentic. Now, I want to talk to you about that. Because you've got to, if you agree with me, you've got to help me with this one. Hillary is 100% authentic. This is who she is. She's not a backslapper. She's not at ease being a politician. She's a workhorse. I've seen it. She knows more than anybody in the room because she studies hard. This is who she is. She's a worker. She cares. She wants to get things done. She's a strategist. She knows so many things. And I was there with her in the Senate and with Bernie. And I could tell you, when we were in the back rooms figuring out how to stop them from taking away a woman's right to choose, Hillary was there. And she was on the floor. And she was figuring it out. Has she made mistakes in her life from my point of view in terms of some of the votes? Yes. Has she said the four words that politicians can't stand to say? I made a mistake. She'd said that a few times. And I'll talk to you about the emails. Okay, you need to understand. Every single United States senator uses their personal email for business. We do. The difference between us and the State Department is, in the State Department, when Colin Powell took over, there were rules that were printed up that said that you should keep all the copies of your emails that were used on your personal email. You should print them out contemporaneously and put them in a pile. And that started, and your staff had to do it too. So that started with Colin Powell. He did not do that. He actually erased every one of his personal emails, and they are gone. They are somewhere in the clouds. Condi Rice said she never wrote an email. I'll take her at her word, but her staff did, and they said they deleted theirs too. Hillary Clinton now comes in. She does the same thing. It was bad. The only difference is she saved them, recovered them, and turned over 55,000. In the Inspector General report, and I read the whole thing, in the conclusion, which you can read so you can check on me, her name isn't even mentioned. What it says is this email situation and the electronic records have been mishandled by the State Department forever, and it's terrible, and finally John Kerry is doing it the right way. But all the others did not do it the right way. She gets blamed for the whole thing. Nobody, you don't hear anybody saying, that Colin Powell, it's Hillary Clinton. And that's because her detractors want to have you ask me this question tonight. Why is she not likable? I don't know what to say except this. She's likable. She's authentic. I saw her go down to ground zero. She came into the United States Senate a superstar after being First Lady. She never, never was a show horse. She was on a committee in which I was a senior Democrat. She listened. She worked. 8 months into the term, we had 9/11. And she fought for her state. And she was the first one to get past rules and regulations to make sure that those first responders were taken care of. So she's authentic. She's just not an entertainer. You know, this isn't her thing. And I think once people get over that and they see the choice, they are going to say, who do I want to be my president? Someone who's a backslapping politician, or who's so authentic and cute and funny and an entertainer and says everything he wants to, whatever it is, even if it insults two-thirds of the people, or someone who is ready to roll up her sleeves and get to work and do what's right for the country. I write in this book a lot about Hillary because my daughter was married to Hillary's brother. The marriage did not last. And it fell apart just around the time that we were colleagues. Tough, awkward, difficult, really difficult. But I want you to read about her during that period of time. And I really think the next time somebody says, why this, why that, say, I know a lot more about her than you know. I know what she was really like, you know, in a private situation. So I think that's going to be it, or one more?
Let's do one more. And I want to one more. And I want to remind everybody that Senator Boxer is going to be signing books immediately following the program in the atrium. Okay, last question. What's your single most important piece of advice for young women who aspire to become leaders, whether in public service?
I'm losing you. Start again.
What's your single most important piece of advice for young women who aspire to become leaders, whether in public service or in corporate life?
Read this book. Actually, I was thinking about that. Terrific for people graduating from college, because my view is, and I'm sincere about this, it took me a lifetime to figure out how I got to be where, you know, if I hadn't sat down to write this, I wouldn't have realized the elements that make me who I am in my work, which is, like it or not, like the product or not, disagree, agree, you know, I will always tell it like it is, and I'm not afraid. And I really do think it is so important. One of the things I'm noticing, since I'm strongly for Hillary and a lot of people are strongly for Bernie, I get these trolls. I could say, I go out, I do a little tweet about anything, and I get the nastiest things that can't even be repeated. They're even in some ways more vulgar than what I read you. And I realized, and I speak to the young women and men who are out in the audience, you are dealing with an anonymous social networking system where people can say crap about you. Excuse me for being unsenatorial for a minute. And lies about you and nastiness. And they don't put their name on it and they don't pay a price for it. And I'm noticing, I mean, what do I care? At this point in my life, I have these people doing this to me, you know? And it's an added problem in many ways. So you have to be, you really do need to know the art of tough and how to handle it. And the most important thing, so there's 9 rules of the art of tough, and one of them is counterintuitive. And I'll end with this. I have been lucky in my life to have love around me. Love from my family, love from friends. And without love in your life, you really can't go where you want to go and do what you want to do and withstand the slings and arrows that come to all of us, whatever we do. So, one of the rules of the art of tough is you got to find love. And if it's not really love, get rid of it. And I tell a story about that when I was a young 16, 17-year-old. So as a young person today, you have all of these things to deal with that I didn't have, the constant information, right? Communication, anonymity, all of this. So as a young woman or man setting out for yourself, be clear on what it is you want. Surround yourself with people who will support you through thick and thin. Know that you're going to fall down, because you will. And I have plenty. And it's the way you get up. And that's why when I look at Hillary Clinton and I see her with all the stuff that's been thrown, the personal stuff, the ugly stuff, the nasty stuff, and I see her standing like this and talking about the world, I think, wow. To be standing after that, and as a young person, you got to be ready to have that network behind you. Know what you want. Don't give up on it. You will fall, but you will get back up. And I'm very optimistic about the young people that I meet. I'm very optimistic, even though we are facing a very tough November, that the American people will do the right thing. And I am so happy that you came out tonight. They could have been doing a million other things. Thank God the Warriors weren't playing tonight. They are something else. And I guess now that I've, you know, I'm a senator, so I do go on. So I am going to close about the Warriors. There is something, when you look at the Warriors, that's another learning experience as you watch them. Their strength in numbers, right? They don't stand there and yell at one another, insult one another. Other teams actually do. I've seen it. And some coaches do that. You never see Steve Kerr doing that. And that's a lesson for all of us in our lives. And it is certainly a lesson for the two nominees for president that we're going to see face off. One of them tears us down. The other one lifts us up. And I hope we're smart enough to see the difference. I hope you'll buy the book. I'm looking forward to signing it for you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Fran, did I see you out there? Hi, Fran.